الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله today is the 21st day of our month of fasting, the month of Ramadan, and the 21st day also of our course that we started known as the spiritual cardiologist, where we're trying to rectify the diseases of our hearts to do with our nafs, to do with our qalb, and in order to achieve qalbin salim, the sound heart that is required by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we all leave this dunya, inshallah. And the topic that we're covering today is in sequence to one of the topics we covered previously. We did the topic, if you might recall, of hubbud dunya, yani having love for, excessive love for dunya. Today's topic is called karayat al-maut, any fear of death. And actually, it's not really, karayat al-maut is not really translated as fear of death, although it might appear on the slides that the people are viewing as fear of death. Karayat al-maut is actually agitation, irritation of death. That you're not, because this is, when you have karayat against something, it means you're agitated by it, you're annoyed by it. So it's not that you fear death, it's that you're irritated by the very thought of death. It irritates you. It's not something comfortable for you to talk about. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah An-Kabut, He mentions in ayah number 20, in ayah number 57, He says, "Kullu nafsin za'iqatul maut," that every soul shall taste death. And so it is in every culture, in every part of the world, in every tradition, death is a reality. And it's part of our, reality. There is no person on the face of this earth who would deny death. That I do not believe in death, because I don't think this is something realistic. Everybody has to go through it. If you like it, if you don't like it, you have to go through it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Thumma ilayna turja'un," that, and then you will be returned back to us. Everyone will die, and then He gives you the answer, what happens after you die. That after you die, you go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not that, you know, people have different opinions about death. That maybe we will die and we will become animals. Or maybe after we die, we will become dust and nothing's going to happen. Or maybe after we die, we will be, all of us will be forgiven. Or maybe after we die, you know, our awliya, or maybe some of the pious people, they will protect us, they will save us. Like some people, even now in our part of the world, they believe that the pious people, they will be standing at the gates of Jahannam, and they will be holding off everyone who used to follow them, and they will throw them in Jannah. So this is against what the Quran teaches us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, death is a reality. Kullu nafsin za'iqatul maut. And sometimes this is often lost in translation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, use the word za'iqa, which means what? Taste. So each and every single one of you will taste the flavor of death. Right now, if I ask you, what's the flavor of death? Like, we don't know. I don't know what it tastes like. But the Prophet, even the Prophet, when he was right before he passed away, he actually used to say that, you know, really this is tough. The sakrat al-maut, the pangs of death, so zaiqatul maut, that's stage one, before your death. And the actual aftertaste is that when your soul is ripped out of your body. So for some people, the taste might be pleasant afterwards. And for other people, the taste might be horrible afterwards. Because the taste for the believer will be when his soul is pulled out of his body, like water pours out of a vessel. Very easy, very smooth. But for the disbeliever, or for that person who disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his soul will be ripped out, yanked out of his body. It will really hurt. And so this is now a problem. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's why He says, "Kullu nafsin za'iqatul maut." And so when we look at definitions of what is karayatul maut, what is this hate for death? The ulama mentioned this as dislike of death when one flees from it, or when one is annoyed by its mention. For example, when somebody flees from the battlefield because he actually fears death. Or for example, when someone is annoyed by the very concept of death or its mention. And so you come into a state of denying death, or the time of death, or the fact that it will occur to a person. Because it's not necessary that you deny it verbally. You could deny it through your actions. Because your actions might... So your actions might show... And here we ban kar dein. So your actions might show that maybe you are a person who is denying death. Lights back on? Do we have light back? Can you check the AC if it's actually working? It's off. Okay, then everybody can relax. Okay, so sometimes through our actions, we could deny death. Because our actions could be of those people who seem to be living their life as if they're not going to die. And it's not a surprise. If you look around you, if you look at the people and generally observe public, you'll seem to think as if nobody's dying here. As if everybody is going to live forever. This is how people behave sometimes. Which is shocking, because how can you behave that way when you all know that one day you have to die? So it's a state of ghafla. It's a state of heedlessness. And so you will meet it. You will meet death. And the position or the place where you will die, it is already marked out for you. You know, for example, if it was, you know, those YouTube videos where like a football player dies in the middle of the pitch, you know, it was written for him, he will die at that same spot, inside the penalty area, 2 feet inside from the top and let's say 7 feet from the sides. That's what was written for him. So every single person's place is already determined. And as soon as you cross that threshold, as soon as you cross that line, this is it, time's up. And so we find that some of the ulama, they said that, you know, you treat yourself as if each and every one of us is on death row. Because this is really what the reality is. Each and every single one of us is on death row. And I had an opportunity to actually visit Adiyala jail and to talk to some of the prisoners there. And I tried to speak to some of the prisoners also on death row. And really, I tell you, you speak to those people, it will change your worldview. Really, it will change you. Because these are people who know for sure that they are going to die, maybe in 2 days, maybe in 1 day, maybe in 5 days, maybe in 7 days, maybe in like a month's time. But they know that they're on death row. Sazai maut likh di gayi hai inke liye. And so what happens is that the guards of the jail, they do not tell these people. The guards know when they're going to die. The guards have the dates on the rostrum, but they don't tell these people. So when the time comes, one fine morning, just like every other day, the guard goes to the prison cell. He asks the guy, come out, it's time to wash you or it's time to have your morning breakfast or something. Right after breakfast, instead of dropping him off at the cell, they take him to the execution chamber where he's executed. And this guy till that time does not know. So he is counting, he has no idea. He knows he has to die, there's no way of escape. And the reason why they don't tell them is because fear of escape. Because if you were to know that I am due for execution in 5 days, then I have 5 days. So it puts you in that state of not knowing. And so what happens to these people? You tell them that, you know, embrace Islam now. Whatever has happened has happened. Because even if you repent, Allah can still forgive you. As long as you make an oath that you want to change yourself. And so some of these people, they do make tawbah. They make sincere tawbah. At that time, everybody's thinking, you know, my life is over. There is nothing I can do except to seek repentance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever it is that I've done. So it's a very sober state of affairs. Very sober. And it humbles you as well. If you go and talk to these people, it humbles you down. So the ulama said that each and every single one of us is on death row. We are all doomed to execution. And none of us knows when the executioner will come to call our name. Just like the person in the jail cell does not know, likewise we do not know when our time will be. And don't tell yourself that, no, I have 50 years to live. I still have 60 years to live. Who knows? We don't have any contract from Malak al-Maut, from the angel of death. And so if you don't have that, then we need to humble ourselves and be realistic. Because how many people are there who thought they were going to make it till the evening and it didn't happen? How many people woke up one morning thinking, I'm going to do all of this today? They made a to-do list and they died that same morning. How many people took a car or a bus or a plane or just simply walked out of their house and they died? So death will come to you and it was already decreed for you. It's already written down. The date and time and place of your death is already decreed. So for a believer, he does not need to worry. He knows it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever it will be, I need to make sure I am prepared to meet Allah. That's what I need to make sure of. And so another example of this could be that, imagine that all of us are sitting on a conveyor belt. You know what's a conveyor belt? You know what you have in factories? Or what you have at the luggage department at airports? Imagine we're all sitting on a conveyor belt right now. and we have to reach the end. And the end is the day of judgment. But before that time, somebody's going to pick us up off the conveyor belt, like people collecting luggage. So the angel will be sent forth and he will be told, collect this. And the conveyor belt ends on the day of judgment. Because some people will make it to the end in the day of judgment. And that's when they will die. When the horn will be blown, that's when they will die. And then they will be resurrected. So some people make it to the end, some people are picked off. But at the end of the day, everybody gets picked off. The question is, what have you prepared? Like the man who came to the Prophet and said, Matasaha, when will the hour be? The Prophet said, the hour will come. And it's considered to be bad manners to talk about death or to bring it up in a conversation. You know, for example, you go to a wedding and you're like, okay, let's talk about death for a minute. They're like, well, what's wrong with you? Are you crazy? Or if it's like any occasion, you say, you know, 5 minutes upon death. For 1 hour, we've talked about, you know, cars and handbags and shoes and clothes. Let's give 5 minutes to death. And the people will be like, please, this is not on. Don't talk about death. And so the only time people do think that people are dying is when somebody's ill. Like two people who are having a conversation about somebody who is about to die. And they think because that person is, they say the person is on his deathbed because he's sick. Maybe Allah will give him shifa, he will be fine. And one of you who is making conversation will die before him. But this thought never crosses our mind because we think because he's old, he's an uncle, he's old and he's sick, therefore he's going to go before me. Who says? Tomorrow morning. So this is how Shaitan deludes us from the reality. And this is not to say that we become very morbid people. Like, you know, we're always like, for example, talking about doom and gloom. No. But this is to have some kind of soberness in our gatherings. And so it should not be the case that when you hear about death, it bothers you and that you want to change the subject to something which is more light and fun. And as people say, you know, make us laugh. Say something to entertain us. And subhanAllah, in the culture in which we are, this is excessiveness because we live in a culture where we're expected to make jokes all the time. We're expected to make people laugh all the time. This is like the culture of comedy. You know, where you're imagining applause and laughter after everything you say. And you can hear it. It's almost as if you can hear it. You know, people laughing in the background. So it's almost always that we want to make jokes about everything. Everything becomes a joke. Even serious matters become a joke. So this is not what Islam teaches us. Islam says you can have fun, but life is not all about fun. You have to have a balance. Like the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned in the hadith, mentioned in Bukhari's Adab al-Mufrad and Tirmidhi ibn Majah and the Muslims of Imam Ahmad, he said that do not laugh much, too much, for verily excessive laughter, it kills the heart. If you laugh too much, it'll make your hearts hardened. It'll kill it. So don't have excessive laughter. And this is exactly the kind of culture we're actually in. We'll have channels dedicated completely to comedy. 24 hours a day comedy. Laugh, 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 laugh. And this is a state of ghafla. This is a state of heedlessness. Because why are you laughing? Because one time one of the scholars, he saw, I think it was Hasan al-Basri, he saw a few people laughing hysterically. They were going crazy and they were laughing with their mouths open, high-fiving one another. And he passed by them and he said, Subhanallah, you guys have been given your book of deeds in your right hand. You have been given a ticket to Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you people of Jannah. You're laughing so much. Is that the case? Have you crossed the pool of Sirat? What? Why are you laughing so much? He was like, I'm surprised that you would laugh so hysterically because these people were going crazy with laughter. He said, what is it? You know, what good news have you received? Please share with me also. So this is what the Prophet says, that excessive laughter, it'll actually kill your heart. Like the hadith from Ibn Majah, where the Prophet said, "Aksaru zikra hazim al-lazzat," remember frequently the destroyer of pleasures. And by that he meant death. Remember frequently. And you know, we're not saying, he didn't say sometimes remember it. He said frequently, oftentimes. And so even if people bring it up at one conversation, you'll have like a problem. You can't talk about death. Aksiru. that remember it frequently, often, not sometimes, that even if you mention it once, remember it quite frequently. And so that is why we need to understand and highlight what our gatherings should be like, what type of gatherings should we have. So for example, we are told not to have majalis al-ghafla, a majalis that are heedless majalis, where it is all about joking, laughter, making fun, talking about other people and that sort of stuff. You need to have a balance. Also have the tawfiq to make dua about people. Make dua about yourselves. And also do zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like for example, we are also told the dua of the expiation of an assembly, that you say, Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. So if you don't say that, then that gathering is devoid of khair. How can you have a gathering where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name was not mentioned? How can you have a gathering where the Prophet was not mentioned? And so what was the purpose of all of this? Because try to understand, we were created for ibadah. We were created for worship of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran, in Surah Zariyat, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. So what was your gathering about? If it was a gathering of, for example, why am I being pulled? Okay, for example, if it was a gathering of, for example, laughter and play, then why is it that you forgot your purpose in that gathering? And you made no mention of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Did you forget about Him? Did you forget about Yawm al-Qiyamah? So you can have fun, you can play around, you can have sports, it's all halal inshallah. But do not forget Allah. Do not forget Allah. Because those who forget Allah, Allah forgets about them. And those who remember Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remembers them. So inshallah we should have that. And the Prophet in the hadith mentioned in At-Tirmidhi, he said, no people sit in a gathering without mentioning Allah and without asking Allah for blessings on their Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, except that it will cause sorrow upon them. Thus, if Allah wishes, He will punish them, and if He wishes, He will forgive them. So any gathering where Allah is not mentioned, or where people do not send salawat on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this gathering is devoid of khair. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, either He will punish them, or He might forgive them, but they will suffer some consequence, they will suffer some sorrow as a result of this gathering, even if it may be in the dunya. So inshallah, we need to be very careful about our gatherings, no matter where they are. And so what we understand is that in the case of the believers, we need to make peace with death. We need to understand, internalize and realize that death is a reality, and we have to come to grips with it. Acceptance of death itself is an acceptance of the decree of Allah. Because you realize it is the qadr of Allah, I have to go and I have to go. And whenever my time comes, I have to go. There is no fighting it. There is no denying it. And so this will put you in a state of itminan. Because you make peace with the fact that you have to return to Allah. And the only people who do get forgiven are those people who are in a state of itminan. Ya ayyatuhal nafsul mutmainna irji ila rabbiki radiyatan mardiya fadkhuli fi ibadi wadkhuli jannati. O you tranquil nafs, come back to your Lord in a state where it is pleasing to Allah and it is pleasing to you, and come back into the company of the righteous slaves of Allah, and come into the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what Allah is saying. But this is for nafsul mutmainna, who is in a state of itminan. Because a person who is already fearing death, how on earth could it be that he is in a state of itminan? A person who right before his death was panicking. No, I don't want to die. Please save me. And he's dead. This is not nafsul mutmainna. Nafsul mutmainna is that you accept the inevitable. And you say, La ilaha illallah. And you go back to Allah. Because the ulama say that the believer, he is actually looking forward to meeting Allah. That's one of his qualities. He's looking forward to meeting Allah, because that is for him a higher maqam. That's a higher station for him. And so that's why some of the ulama said that death should be a celebration for a Muslim, not for those who he has left behind. That instead of a janazah, they start celebrating. No, that's still 3 days of mourning. But what he's saying is that it should be a celebration for the true believer. Why? Because for the true believer, death is a blessing. And they gave evidence for that. They said, because his disease will end because of death. With death, all diseases are dead. No more heart attack, no more diabetes, no more any other problems. Number two, all of his suffering will end. Whatever suffering from people, from other people he was going through, this is over for him. Thirdly, all of his pain is gone with death. for the believer. For the disbeliever, this is the beginning of pain. So for the true believer, he's happy. He's like, okay, alhamdulillah, my pain is gone. And fourthly, he's going from a worse place to a better place. From economy class, he's been bumped up to first class. And I don't know if you've had that experience. Alhamdulillah, I've had this experience many times. Actually, every single time I've traveled alone from Abu Dhabi to Islamabad or Dubai to Islamabad, every single time when I've traveled alone with my family, I stay in economy. And my wife complains because of that. That why is it that whenever you're alone, you get bumped up? I said, I don't know. It's some tawfiq from Allah. So they always see my face. They're like, come on, first class, alhamdulillah. So it's been the case for many, many times, maybe 6-7 times. So what happens is, nobody denies that. If somebody says to you that we want to move you from economy to first class, nobody says, no, I don't want to go. Or for example, it has also happened that, for example, I booked a place in a hotel, which was like a normal room, and they gave me the presidential suite. They said, oh, I'm sorry, we don't have that room available. Would you like to stay in the presidential suite? I was like, no. Of course I'd like to stay in the presidential suite. Absolutely, yes. He said, okay, please join us. So if Allah offers you something better, of course we realize that the grave itself becomes like a garden of Jannah for the true believer. The grave expands. It becomes even more real than this dunya. And you sleep like a new bride, anticipating, can't wait for the day of judgment to come. This is the state of a believer. And your good deeds come in the form of a very handsome person, sweet smelling, very amazing smell. And he shows you a window of hellfire, that this is what you have missed, this is not where you're going. And then he shows you a window of Jannah, that this is your home. He shows you a picture of your home in Jannah. And you're like, wow, I can't wait to go there. And he says, go to sleep now, relax, take it easy. And you sleep in the most amazing way. And you're like, and when you sleep, you're like, Ya Allah, make the day of judgment come right now. And he says, go to sleep now, you'll be woken up by the most beloved. You'll be woken up by your most beloved. SubhanAllah, this is the case of a believer. So for him, you know, he should be excited that he's dead. After he's dead. So this is the case of a true believer. But for a disbeliever, you know, he hates death. He's got everything to worry about, because for him, you know, the grave constricts to a point that even his rib cage collapses on itself. And then his deeds come in the form of a hideous beast, stinking. And he shows him a window of Jannah. This could have been your place had you been a true worshipper. But no, this is not for you anymore. And this is hasra, this is regret. And he shows him a picture of his home in Jahannam. This is the fire where you will remain. And before that, here is a teaser, a taste of things to come. And he's even tortured inside of the grave. So the case for a believer and disbeliever is very, very different. So for a person, a true believer, he's getting bumped up to first class, if you realize it from that point of view. And so we find that nobody deals with death or calamities in the way that a true believer deals with it. You know, you can actually look at world history and see how people dealt with their problems. For example, when an earthquake hits South America, or if a tsunami comes, or if there's a hurricane or something, how do people deal with that? And the practicing people, those Muslims who are practicing, who have yaqeen and qadr of Allah, they'll be like, alhamdulillah, you know, it's the will of Allah. And inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, he actually put us through this test. Inshallah, he will take us out and we will have something beneficial, inshallah. Because there is khair in everything. That's what the believer believes. But for the non-Muslim, for the person who doesn't believe in Akhirah, who doesn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who doesn't believe in his decree, he has everything to worry about. Because he can't cope. He's like, why me? And why is all this happening to me? What did I do to deserve this? So he becomes very confused. And so we know that even in Islam, how can believers deal with their grief? Because in Islam, there's only 3 days of mourning. There's no fourth day. So 3 days you mourn and then you're actually back to business. So even though people pass, of course it's a hurtful thing. Of course it's hurtful. But we move on because life continues. And so in some cultures we find that they drag it on for years sometime. A person dies and they keep dragging it on and on and on. And mourning becomes an industry. The black outfits, the veils and all of that, this becomes an industry. And so people go on and on. And so even for example in Indian culture, they have those, I don't know, agarbattis or something that they put around, and they have garlands. They take the picture of the deceased person, they hang it up on the wall, they put garlands around it, agarbatti, underneath it, vegetables and fruits, and I don't know what, mithai, they have to circulate. And so this is an industry now. That they say every single day you have to mourn For how many days? I don't know for how long this will actually take place. And so it's painful, but the at the end we realize it's the decree of Allah. And one of the French scientists, Maurice Bocaille, who accepted Islam, he mentioned that one of the things that convinced him about the authenticity of Islam, one of the things, apart from the scientific miracles he observed in the Quran, he said that it was the way, because he was French, he said the way the French people dealt with their dead, and the way the Algerian Muslims in France, they dealt with a deceased person. He said that one people would be panicking, crying frantically and all that, and on the other side, they would still be crying, but very sober. And, you know, giving each other a pat on the back, inshallah, it's okay, having good confidence, you know. So he said, because of that, I realized these people have something, these people don't. Because he would deal frequently with people who were ill or sick and so on. So he said that I actually saw this very confused, I'm very confused that both of them are human beings. One of them reacts in such a cool way, the other group is just breaks down to the point that even some family members might commit suicide. That because my wife is dead, I have no reason to live. My husband is there, I have no reason to live. And you find this even in Indian culture and so on. If the husband dies, oftentimes the wife would die with him. That you have no reason to live anymore. And so this is a very morbid state of affairs. Islam does not encourage that in any way, shape or form. So the thing is, what we have to understand is that the most important thing for us that we'll ever do, according to some of the ulama, they said that the most important thing you will ever do in your life is that you will die. You know when you have a to-do list that today I did this, I did this, I did this. The most important thing on that to-do list is that I died today. Because the way you die really determines what happens to you in the hereafter. The Prophet ﷺ said that whoever says La ilaha illallah before they die, right before they die on their deathbed, وَدَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ, he enters paradise. But this is not as easy as it might seem. If your life was upon La ilaha illallah, you will say it. If your life was other than La ilaha illallah, you will not have the tawfiq to say it. Like, for example, one of the doctors from Sydney, he mentioned that 38 people died on his operating table. And he said, I told each and every single one of them, say La ilaha illallah. And he's talking about Muslims, by the way. He said, I told each and every single one of them, say La ilaha illallah. Out of 38, two of them said La ilaha illallah. 36 didn't say it. And he said, somebody was reciting poetry. Someone was singing songs. Someone was doing numbers. I don't know what was going on. So at the stupors of death, you only remember what your life was upon. This intoxicated state of death, you will only remember what you lived your life on. If all your life was about, let's say, cricket, then on your deathbed, you'll be talking about Shahid Afridi. If all your life was calculating numbers, you were an accountant, always doing numbers, doing numbers, doing numbers, that's all you cared about, then on your deathbed, you'll be doing numbers. And Ibn al-Qayyim rahimullah, in his book, Dua-i Shafi, he mentions, I don't know how many incidents of different people who died doing different things while they were dying. He said, some people were singing songs and we told them, stop it. Say La ilaha illallah. And he said, he didn't say it. He said, some people were doing numbers. Some people were, talking about their business, their property. Some people, and so lots of different things people talk about. And so we find that there are people who, because it's the most important thing in your life, death. It's the most important thing. So some people, they know how to die. They know how to do this job really well. And you might ask, how can you practice death? How can you possibly know how to die because you only die once, right? So how could you possibly be good at it? That there are some people who are very good at dying. They really know how to die well. And so ulama gave examples of people who did very, very miraculous and strange things. But I'll mention some of them. For example, if you're in a constant state of zikr, like the Prophet said that, you know, keep your tongues moist with the zikr of Allah. If you keep your tongue always moist with the zikr of Allah, it is very highly likely that at the time of your deathbed, you'll be able to do zikr as well. You'll be able to say La ilaha illallah. Because all your life, you know, in your spare time, you're always doing zikr. Your tongue was always moist with La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah. And one brother I knew, he was in a demotivated state of affairs, practicing brother, mashallah. He was demotivated. And he said that, you know, I have a problem because I think that my iman level is not there. And if I die, I don't know if I'll die on Islam. I'm not really sure because, you know, your iman keeps going up and down. So he said that one day, I went to the masjid, prayed Fajr prayer. And I was trying to, you know, build my iman. He said, that day I went to get a mobile phone, a brand new mobile phone. And I got the mobile phone and I was taking it to my downstairs portion. So he was coming down and he was opened the pack up. He was opening it while walking downstairs. Not a good idea. So his phone fell from his hand. Brand new phone, Nokia by the way. And it slipped out of his hand and it went down like 10 stairs. And he said, the moment the phone slipped out of my hand, I knew obviously that this is it. The phone is out. So the first word that came out of my mouth was, Alhamdulillah. And he said, that's when I said, Alhamdulillah, or something like this, Subhanallah, or something. And he actually went to pick up the phone, and he said, okay, is it fine? Okay, Alhamdulillah, it's fine. And then he realized what just happened. And he said, in the stupors of death, so to speak, in the stupors where I was, where something suddenly happened, the word that came out of my mouth was not, oh, sugar, you know, or something other than that. The word that came out of my mouth was, Alhamdulillah, or something righteous. So he said that this gave me comfort that even if I'm about to die, I'm hopeful and I pray, because this gave him a lot of confidence. That Alhamdulillah, even in, and so look at yourselves. When you trip and fall, what do you say? When something hits you, what do you say? When somebody bumps you, what do you say? What is the automatic, because if it's Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, then this is a good sign. But if it's other than that, then it's a problem, because the Prophet said you will be resurrected the way you die. So if a person is dying in an accident and a car is about to hit him and he said something really terrible, like, oh, something, beep, censored. And so just whatever he said, he will be resurrected before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying the exact same words. Like the Prophet mentioned that a person who died saying, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik, he will be resurrected saying the same words in a state of ihram. And so imagine facing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the first thing you say is a cuss word. This is a problem. So that's why zikr is very important. So those people who are constantly engaged in zikr, they are actually preparing for death. I'm preparing now. I'm doing the homework now. I'm putting the hours now. So that when the time comes, I'm able to deliver. The second thing they mention is that to be at total peace with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, having good hope in His mercy. Have this relationship with Allah. Ya Allah, I hope that you are pleased with me. Raditu billahi rabba wa bil islami deena wa bi Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam nabiyya. I'm pleased with, and you say that three times in the morning and evening inshallah. I'm pleased with Allah as my Rabb. I'm pleased with Islam as my deen. I'm pleased with the Prophet as my Nabi. So you say that and you become in a state of peace with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so likewise, you have this relationship with Him where you know that your relationship is good based on husna zan. But this is not that kind of husna zan that you keep doing sin and then have good hopes from Allah. It is you try your best according to your level of istitaat. And so some of the ulama, they said that at the time of your deathbed, have nothing else except good hope in Allah. Don't panic at that moment. Don't think, oh, I'm doomed. Life is over. This is it. You know, I'm going to go to the fire. Don't think that. Have good hope at that time. Be in a state of itminan, because ya ayyatuhan nafsul mutmainnah. So don't be in a state of panic at that time. So at your deathbed, the ulama say, relax, calm down. Whatever's happened, happened. Just say, do lots of zikr, make lots of istighfar, and do all of those things. One of the scholars, he was in Riyadh, and the doctors told him, don't move from here. And he had this urge. He said, you know what, I want to travel to Medina. And he said, you can't go because you're actually not well. So he said, I just want to go for a day. And this was a day of Friday. He said, I just want to go for a day. I just want to pray Jummah in Medina. And I'll come back to Riyadh in the evening, inshallah. My son will drive me. They said, you know, we really don't advise it. But if you want to go, then fine. But just take care of yourself. Don't exert yourself. He said, no, I'll just travel on the wheelchair and I should come back. Throughout, he made zikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was doing zikr all throughout in the car. His son mentioned, he was just saying, La ilaha illallah. All day, he did no other zikr except La ilaha illallah. And he prayed Jummah and everything. And he died on the day of Jummah in Medina, and he was buried in Medina. So sometimes, you know, people just know it, you know, because he was a scholar. And I'm not saying that people have this ghaib ilm or anything. This is just a feeling. Maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes He puts in your heart, and so people know that their time is up. Sometimes they know it. It's just a feeling that, you know, I think this is it. This is the big one. And so he said, you know, I just want to travel to Medina, and the only thing I want right now, the only thing I really desire, is that I pray one last Jummah in Medina. and then I die there. And he was buried there. So subhanAllah, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives tawfiq to whom he wills. Because it's a very high honor to die on the day of Jummah and to be dying in Medina as well on top of that. So they said that some people are just at peace with Allah. They're just in a state of itminan, complete tranquility. They're not panicking, they're not edgy, they're not fighting it, they're not cranky. They're just itminan. That they know death is here and they embrace it. They accept it because at the end of the day, they've done whatever they had to do. They've lived the life that they had to live and now they've made peace with Allah. Ya Allah, whatever I've done of the good, please accept it. Whatever I've done of bad, Ya Allah, you are the most merciful. Ya Allah, please forgive me and have mercy on me, Ya Allah. And so I come to you in peace. And so this is the way a person should really die. So these people also, this is point number two, these are the people who know how to die. Third is people, for example, who make wudu often and stay in a state of wudu because especially before you leave your house. And you might think this is a bit excessive, but really, if you want to meet Allah, then what better way to meet Him in a state of wudu? So if you are worried about it, and if you put yourself into that habit, really you will never leave off wudu. You will always be in that state. So this will have multiple benefits. Number one, you're always in a state of tahara. Number two, you can anytime at the drop of a hat, you can actually pray nafal prayer. You don't have to waste time in, for example, jamaat khadi hogi, ab main kya karu? You're already in a state of wudu. So I would recommend that whenever you actually visit the loo, make wudu and get out. If you make that habit, wallahi, it will keep you very, very, it has multiple benefits. Even shayateen cannot affect the person who is in a constant state of tahara. Shayateen only come to a person who is in a state of ghilaza or najasa, for example. So you have to try to be as much as you can in a state of wudu, because if you do that every time you leave your house, you know, and this happens, it will happen to you inshallah, that you will check, have I made wudu? Because you're saying that because I'm leaving my house, even if I die in an accident, God forbid, I'm still in a state of wudu. Inshallah, I've covered my end. I've got my case secure. I'm secure, alhamdulillah. I'm dying in a state of wudu. It's a good thing. And inshallah, you might have tawfiq to say la ilaha illallah as well because of that. Likewise, reciting Ayatul Kursi after every prayer, because between every prayer, if you say that, then inshallah, you get Jannah. Or Sayyid al-Istighfar, after, for example, at the time of Maghrib or at the time of Fajr, reciting that. So if whoever does that, then even if he dies during that night, he becomes a person of Jannah. Or if a person recites after Fajr, then even if he dies after Fajr, he becomes a person of Jannah. So the people who know how to die, they have already got their ends covered. They already know, I need to make this zikr. It's absolutely essential for me. It's like a vaccine. I must take it. Otherwise, I'm in trouble. Because I don't know if I'll die today or not. So they are always prepared. Likewise, making dua for shahada. This is part of iman as well, by the way. If you don't desire shahada, then this is the problem. So you should have desire for that. And make dua for that. Ya Allah, give me shahada. And sometimes when we joke amongst brothers, this is just a joke, by the way. Sometimes when we joke about practicing brothers, we say, may Allah give you four wives and a bullet in the head. So this is a joke meaning, you know, may Allah give you four wives in dunya and may He give you shahada in Islam. And what this means is that may Allah give you the best of dunya and akhirah, inshallah. Although sometimes people might say, you know, maybe I got the bullet because of the four wives. But inshallah, we have good hopes. What I actually mean to say is that when you pray for shahada, it's, you know, like Umar ibn al-Khattab, he was in Medina. He said, Ya Allah, give me shahada in Medina. Imagine. And the people told him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, there is no war in Medina. This is not a place where we have battles. Battles are outside the city premises. There is no battle inside of Medina. He said, Inshallah, I have good hope in Allah. And wallahi, brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him shahada in Medina. Can you imagine? So ask Allah. If for Allah, it's easy. You can say, Ya Allah, give me shahada in the masjid. Ya Allah, give me shahada in whatever place you want. Pray to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ghani. He can give you whatever you actually want. Make dua. For us, it seems impossible. It seems like, you know, maybe I shouldn't be praying this. No, make dua to Allah. Make whatever you want because it's always good. There's always khair in dua. So Umar ibn Khattab, he said, Ya Allah, give me shahada in Medina. He got it. And the first thing he asked was, you know, he was a very soft-hearted person by the end of it. You know, his whole life. If you study the seerah of Umar ibn al-Khattab, he was very rough and rugged, but towards, you know, he learned to deal with anger. He learned to deal with ghadab and all of these things. And you can look at how a person purified his heart. Wallahi, this is an excellent example of a person who did amazing tazkiyah upon himself. Till the end of it, when he was stabbed, you know, the first question he asked was he a Muslim? They said, no, he wasn't. He said, Alhamdulillah. First question. that I'm happy that a Muslim did not do this to me. Because not that a Muslim would do me and I would be dishonored. No, I did not want a Muslim to be dishonored in a way that he would attack his Khalifa. Because I want to save his life also. Alhamdulillah, I'm happy a Muslim didn't do it. So this was the state of Umar al-Khattab. And he became very soft towards the end. You know, so you actually find how people change. So the first is that. The second is, even if you die defending your property and your family, even that is shahada in Islam. And you might think, why is that shahada? You know, person was defending his house, his wealth, his family. How is that shahada in Islam? It is, according to the authentic hadith of the Prophet, because the ulama say it is the ultimate level of amr bil maruf wa nahy anil munkar. Because if this person was to say, you know what, steal everything you want, take it, because he puts himself on the line, he is doing the ultimate nahy anil munkar. He is stopping with his hand where he has istitaar, and through stopping with his hand, somebody killed him. So he is a martyr in Islam. So maybe you say, Ya Allah, give me shahada in Islamabad. And you die in this manner. And Allah makes you a shaheed. Or maybe you die pursuing the deen of Allah. And you become shaheed. So Allah only knows. So inshallah, at least have the intention. Ya Allah, I desire shahada. Ya Allah, make me a martyr in Islam. Because, you know, even in my jahiliya, when I was in my state of jahiliya, I used to make prayer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, give me shahada. You know why? Because I knew that the amount of sin and transgression that I'm involved in, the only cure is shahada. Because for shahada, you go account free in straight into Jannah. No questions asked. You go by the VIP exit. By the, what is it called? Green room, blue room, I don't know, whatever it is. So you actually go by the special VIP entrance into Jannah. No questions asked, because you died a shaheed. So I used to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even in times of jahiliya, that Ya Allah, I don't know what's going to happen to me. I don't know if I can come towards Islam. I don't know if I can even fulfill the basic obligations. But Allah, I really hope and pray that you can make me a martyr for Islam. And so maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this was the only prayer that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala probably liked in the heart of a sinner. And so maybe because of that, he turned my heart. But only Allah knows. And so inshallah, make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, you actually never know when he will accept it and make it come true immediately. And so we also know that the ulama and have actually informed us of visualization of death. Like for example, the state of death, the state of the family once you have died, the state of you being wrapped in a shroud, the state of the grave, the state of questioning that happens in the grave, the resurrection, the accountability on the day of judgment. Like the scholars would say that, O son of Adam, you are heedlessly going about with dunya when you don't even know that the cloth from which your shroud will be made might have already come to the marketplace. The cloth with which you will be wrapped, maybe that is already in the marketplace, sitting at, you know, Lawrencepur or somewhere. And so it's already there and you don't even know it. And maybe tomorrow, maybe day after, somebody will go, your family member will go and he will say, you know, I need this much piece of cloth. And you are so heedless and your cloth has arrived at the marketplace. So how is it that you are laughing and giggling? So they said that the reason why we have this hate for death is because we are not prepared. Because we haven't prepared for the day of judgment. We haven't prepared for death. That's why a lot of us, they are scared of death. Because we know what is about to come afterwards. Because we are unsure. It's the fear of the unknown. Because a believer who knows what's going to happen, he's in a state of itminan. But a person who does not know what's going to happen is in a state of fear. What's going to happen to me after? I don't know, really I don't know what's going to happen. For the rest of my life, forever and ever, this eternity, where I will spend it, in Jannah or Jahannam, I don't know. And so like a student who comes to an exam, there are two types of students. One of them who comes to the exam prepared, he's relaxed, nafsul mutmainna. Another person who comes unprepared, he's panicking, and he's panicking other people also. Question number 5 yaad kiya, chapter 8 yaad kiya, uska fulana yaad kiya, ata nahi kiya, and he's making everybody panic. And so I used to have people like that as well. I used to just tune out, zone out, just walk away, you know, go somewhere else. And come at the time of examination and just give the paper. Because these people are themselves confused and they make you confused also. At the last minute, they're panicking. So this is the last thing you should be doing on your deathbed. And so we find from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned that whoever loves to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet him. And whoever hates to meet Allah, Allah will hate to meet him. And Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha, she mentioned that, but we all dislike the idea of death. He said, it is not what you are thinking. When death approaches the believer and he is given the news of Allah's pleasure and honor, nothing will be more dear to him than what lies ahead of him. So he will love to meet him. He will love to meet Allah, and Allah would love to meet him. But when death approaches the disbeliever and he is given the news of Allah's wrath and punishment, nothing will be more disliked by him than what lies ahead of him. So he will hate to meet Allah, and Allah will hate to meet him. And just to give you a dunyavi example, although there is, we actually say, laysa kamithli shay, there is no example for Allah. But just to explain, you know, if you've passed the exam, if your O-levels exam, and you are supposed to meet with the principal, along with your parent, if you know you've got all A's, this is a happy occasion, because the principal is going to talk good about you in front of your father. You're like, yes, I'm happy to meet. Let's go and meet her now. Okay, if she's not available, we'll wait an hour. But I want to meet the principal. But on the other hand, if you've flunked and you have F, you know, all F grades, you would hate to meet the principal. Why? Because you know the principal is going to bash you. What happened to you? You are such a good person. You basically lost the plot. What happened? So you don't want to face that. So likewise, the believer is excited to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whereas the disbeliever, he hates to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the hadith from Bukhari narrated by Sa'd bin Ubaid radiallahu anhu, he mentions that the Prophet ﷺ said, none of you should long for death. For if, number one, if a person is a good man, he may increase in good deeds. And if he's an evildoer, he may stop the good deeds and repent. So don't actually desire death. Don't desire it in that sense. Ask Allah for a long life, so that even if you're a good person, you will get tawfiq to do more good deeds. And if you're a sinner, you'll get time enough to repent and turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we find that dislike of death is actually part of our cellular structure. It's part of our cellular structure because our body reacts to dangerous situations. You know, self-preservation is a basic human instinct. And so there is an adrenaline rush. There is a heightened sense of awareness. If, for example, like, five lions were to like walk into this room now, what would happen? Think about this. Obviously, this is a heightened sense of awareness, right? People would run, but maybe they would scream. I hope not, though. But the thing is, people would try to defend themselves. And this is jais in Islam. No problem. Because it's a reflex action to deny death. It's a reflex action. Nobody wants that. Self-preservation is a human instinct. Otherwise, if self-preservation was not an instinct, we would keep our hands on a kettle or on a hot flame without removing it. And we would just burn ourselves. But as soon as we touch it, we let it go because we know it's harmful for us. So we leave it. So the true believer, though, he learns to calm himself down when death is inevitable. That's the only difference. He works on self-preservation also. But when he knows death is inevitable, he embraces it. like the Prophet said, seek refuge from accidental death. That's why he said that. You know, seek refuge from accidental death. Because in accidental death, you don't have that state of itminan. But death other than an accidental one, then you know death is coming. And so you can give yourself time to relax, calm down, make zikr, and die. But in accidental death, you know, one moment you're in a car, the next moment you're what? Bang, you're gone. So that's why he said, seek refuge from that. On the other hand, the completely opposite end of the spectrum, we have the concept of suicide, which is what we can say loving death or desire for death maybe. This is the exact opposite of karayat al maut. This is actually wanting death for yourself, preferring it over all the other options that might be before you. And the Japanese culture is rich with suicidal thought and all of that. Seppuku is a form of self, for example, suicide. And so is harakiri in the samurai culture. And there's a book called Hagakure, the book of the samurai, which I had the honor of reading at one particular point in time. And so I was trying to understand what the samurai way of life is. Because I actually found similarities between the samurai way of life and Islam even. But some parts obviously are completely outside of Islam. But maybe because Allah sent a messenger to all nations, maybe a messenger came to them. You know, Allah knows best. But some of their ways are, you know, honor, dignity, haya, modesty. All of these things were with the samurai. Jihad fi sabilillah is all there. So, and they were warrior people. They were all warriors. And very strong warrior code, very strong. You know, very calm people. On the surface, like water. On the inside, it's a sea of emotions. And you can't understand. And this was the way of the samurai. Very amazing, very fascinating. And now, you know, the person who I asked that, you know, get me the book of, you know, Hagakure from Japan. And they actually brought it back for me, and they said that the person at the counter, they gave him dirty looks. That they so, you know, disagreed with the culture now. Because now the youth, they hate the samurai culture. because the West has made them hate it. Now they like Michael Jackson, they like the song and dance and all that. But their original culture was the samurai culture. A lot of things very common with Islam. But so they would commit suicide for what purpose? One of them was if they had done something dishonorable, they would punish themselves as a process. And they would do it publicly. It was not in like behind closed doors. They would do a public thing, sit down, very proper position. There were adab of sitting down. You know, this is how you sit down with your legs like this, with your outfit like this. You take the knife from this hand, you pick it up, and it's a small knife. And through that, from the left to right, they cut themselves. And they would do it in a swift movement, and that's it. And they would completely tape it up afterwards. And they would sit and wait for death until they would just pass out. Neat and clean. And so they would die also because they would do this also if they feared capture from the enemy. They would rather die with their own hands than to die at the hands of the enemy. And so this was also a form of capital punishment. If somebody did something wrong, then they made this as a punishment that you have to kill yourself. And so the person was asked to do this. And so some people did it. They said in the book of the samurai Hagakure, it was actually mentioned that it was suicide in protest with the Lord's decision. So a lot of times people did it because they were dissatisfied with the decision of Allah, which is exactly why suicide is haram in Islam. That you cannot have a disagreement with the qadr of Allah. So they did it because of that reason, purely suicidal reasons. And so the women, they did something called jigai or jigaki, which is a form of suicide for the women in particular, because they would cut their necks, jugular vein, in a neat fashion. Or for example, slide their arteries or something. And you'll be surprised, the women samurai, the women from the samurai tribes, they were all of them were taught this from a very early age, how to kill yourself. Because they were taught this like we are taught ABC. Because at any point, because our men are fighting, at any point if we fear an invasion, then it's better for you to kill yourself. This was what they were taught. And it was also taught, if your husband dies, then you automatically kill yourself. Obviously, this is not what we endorse. But I'm just saying to you that this was in some cultures, you know, suicide or desire for death was to that extent. And so even today, if you check out Jukai Forest in America, which is in Japan, at the foothills of Mount Fuji, you know, this forest is famous for suicides. Hundreds of people kill themselves in the forest even today. And so you might think, why is this happening in Japan? Because Japan is such a prospering country and all that. Because they are a secular nation. They're almost an atheist nation. They don't believe in Allah. Or the concept of Allah is gone. So therefore, their lives have become hardened. And Allah SWT mentions this in Surah Taha, chapter 20, ayah number 124. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً دَنْكَ. But whoever turns away from our reminder, verily for him is a life of hardship. So whoever turns away from the zikr of Allah, his life becomes very, very difficult. Till the point that he might even kill himself. And so this is why when we say that suicide is haram in Islam, it is considered haram because of its many implications. Also, the person who kills himself in Islam, he continues to kill himself in the same way on the Day of Judgment as well. And this is a punishment for him in the hellfire as well. If he jumps from a building, he keeps jumping and dying, jumping and dying. So he goes through the same torture over and over again. Now, I did have quite a few notes available here, but I'm going to skip to the end because we are short on time. So I'll mention the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he mentioned, actually I'll just mention to you two surahs which I wanted to quote today, but we don't have time. Surah Al-Inshiqaq, chapter 84 of the Quran, and Surah Al-Haqqa, chapter number 69. They're very good if you want to study about death and what's going to happen afterwards. So inshallah, I would highly recommend that. But the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he mentioned that be in the world like a traveler, that be in this world like a traveler, that you are going, you actually move on in life. And Ibn Umar, he said that in the evening, do not anticipate the morning, and in the morning, do not anticipate the evening. Take from your health, from your illness, and from your life and your death. So don't expect that you will live till the evening. Work now. Do actions now. Don't think that you will stay here forever. And so we come to the effects of this remembering of death. What benefit will it give you? The ulama say three benefits mainly, although there are many others. The first one is qana'a, which is to be content with what you have. So when you remember death often, you will be more content with what you have. You will enjoy the experiences of life more. And the philosophy is that the poor person who has no wants is actually rich. And the rich person who has wants is actually poor. So if you are content with whatever you have, alhamdulillah, you are free of need. You're free. you are not really poor. But a person who is rich and he still has more desire, I want this, he is in fact the one who is poor. So inshallah, when you are content with whatever you have, this is something that happens as a result of remembering death. Also, what it does to you is it will make you more obedient to Allah. And it will make you leave off sin the more you remember death. And thirdly, it will give you tawfiq to hurry towards tawbah. And so even if you slip, even if you make a mistake, you will hurry towards istighfar if you remember death. But if you don't remember death, then you will be like, you know, abhi to maine marna nahi, abhi now I have 20 years, 30 years to give. So I can repent, you know, I'll make hajj when I'm 60 and then everything will be fine. But if you remember death often, then you will inshallah keep yourself in check. And finally, we come to the cures. There are 9 cures inshallah. The first one is obviously frequent remembering of death. Add death to your occasions. Talk about it often. Mention it. Talk about people who died in a noble cause, so on and so forth. Number 2, prayer on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It has many, many benefits. And there was a hadith I had to quote, but I skipped it. It was about the man who asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I pray on you a quarter. And he said, what if you prayed more? He said, okay, I'll pray half. He said, what if you prayed more? He said, okay, I'll increase that. He said, okay, what if you prayed more? He said, well, I'll make all of my prayer just on you. And he said, then you will have no worry, no anguish, no grief. And Allah will listen to your prayers. So this is what it is. So inshallah, we make lots of durood on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The third is to read about the lives of the righteous, how they lived and died. The Sahaba, the Tabi'in, the Taba Tabi'in, those who were shaheed for Islam, read about their lives and inshallah it will motivate you, encourage you and make you more in terms of having this comfort that, you know, alhamdulillah, I would love to meet Allah in the same manner. You know, like the Sahabi who, he got married, Hanzala, he got married and right after marriage, on the wedding night, the call came for the Battle of Uhud. And he had not even, he had relationship with his wife. And he had not even had time to make ghusl. And the call came that the people are being called for the Battle of Uhud. He ran without making ghusl. And he died. He actually was shaheed in that battle. And the Prophet said that the angels gave him a bath when they were raising him up. So he was the one who was washed by the angels. And that was his lakab in Islam. So there are people who desired shahada more than they desired anything else in dunya. And imagine this was the first, this was his wedding night and he had left. So, you know, this is amazing iman of these people. So we know that read about the lives of the righteous, how they lived and died. Number 4, be content with little. Whatever Allah has given you, be satisfied with that. And don't have too much desire. Don't have too much desire for I want more than this. I only have a Nokia, this I want now an iPhone. Now I want a Samsung Galaxy. Now don't have too many desires. Be satisfied with whatever you have. It's doing the job, right? Alhamdulillah, move on. The fifth thing is doing your own muhasibah, do your own accountability. Hold yourself accountable, like Umar ibn Khattab would say, hold yourself accountable before you are held accountable. So do your own muhasibah. Where am I? How close am I to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What are my faults? What are my mistakes? And this, the purpose of this course, by the way, one of them is to do our own muhasibah. Because this entire course is on tazkiyah. It's all about cleansing ourselves. So inshallah, I hope that by the end of it, we find ourselves to be better people than we were when we actually began this course. The sixth one is to make excessive tawbah, be in a state of tawbah. So that the Prophet ﷺ used to make tawbah 70 or 100 times a day. And so when you make lots of tawbah, you know that alhamdulillah, I've made tawbah to Allah. Inshallah, if I die in this state, inshallah, Allah would forgive me. And you have good hopes in Allah. The seventh is to pray for shahada from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The eighth is to being prepared for death at all times, like I mentioned earlier, to be in a state of wudu, doing lots of zikr, inshallah, have that, to be prepared at all times. You know, every time you leave your house, mentally you should know that, what if I die today? And it's not morbid. Really, it's not. It's a natural state of affairs. And so you just prepare yourself. Have I made my wudu? Have I recited Ayatul Kursi? Have I recited Sayyid al-Istighfar? And so if you know that, alhamdulillah, go out. But if you haven't, then just stay 5 minutes more back and just, you know, make sure you actually do that. The final thing is, number 9, is reciting Quran with understanding, especially, and this is my personal note bracket, reciting Quran personally, especially the last two paras. Because the last two paras, wallahi, they will wake you up and shake you up. Especially surahs like Surah Al-Qiyamah, Surah Waqiyah, Surah Al-Haqqah, really they are soul shakers. So if you actually listen to them, listen to a good Qari reciting it, read his translation, listen to the Qari again, read translation, do it 4-5 times. Wallahi, it will shake you to your core. I guarantee it. I guarantee it, inshallah. So if you can do that, then this is an amazing cure. And I pray that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to cleanse our hearts of all of our illnesses, all of the blemishes. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to have qalbin saleem, the kind of heart that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be pleased to see. I pray that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to die upon la ilaha illallah, and may He forgive us for all of our past sins, the saghira and the kabira. And may He be pleased with us on Yawm al-Qiyamah, granting us a final resting place near Him in Jannat al-Firdaus al-Ala. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina azab an-nar. Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana wa hab lana min ladunka rahma innaka antal wahhab. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka antas samiul alim wa tub alayna innaka antat tawwabur rahim. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Jazakumullahu khairan wa assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The brothers who want to leave can leave, inshallah. Do we have any online questions? Okay, first of all, I would like to know who's asking the question. Is it a brother? Okay, alhamdulillah. Is it a brother I know? Okay, alhamdulillah. Okay, so I think I know what this is. If a person dies due to bungee jumping or skydiving, the ulama say that if you die because of something that it is not likely that you will die as a result of it. Like, for example, if you're engaged in a sport and it's not likely that you will die, then this is not suicide. But for example, Sheikh bin Baz, he actually gave a fatwa that if the speed limit is 120 and you were driving at 140 and you died, he said this is suicide. Let me repeat that. He said if the speed limit is 120 and you died at, let's say, 140 or 160, that was what your actual speed was, then this was suicide. Although Sheikh Uthaymeen, he contested him, because Sheikh Uthaymeen, he used to drive very fast. So he said that I disagree with the Sheikh, because obviously the person who gave this fatwa must have, he actually said, the person who gave this fatwa must have been blind. And he knew who gave it. And Sheikh bin Baz actually was blind. So he said that the person who gave this fatwa, clearly he does not know what driving is and what the pleasure is that we get out of driving. So there is ikhtilaf, but I mean, obviously don't put yourself in a dangerous situation. Because regardless of that, if you are putting yourself deliberately into a deliberate situation where the chances of death become very high, then this will be considered suicide. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. So don't do crazy things which are so dangerous that there is no safety net, there is no harness, there is no this and that. And so there is a room for adrenaline sports, but it's a very narrow corridor.
But
the thing is, in driving, if you're driving from in like a sector, you're only at 30 kilometers an hour, and chances are that you might hit your car, and that's pretty much it. But bungee jumping, if the cord snaps, then there's no way you're getting out. And likewise, I asked my instructor when I was skydiving, I actually asked him, you know, how many times have people died out of skydiving? He said, you know, we've had very rare incidents. You know, people jump. There are people who jump like 2,000 plus jumps. You know, there are people who jump more than 400 times in a year. That means, you know, for a day, they jump every single day. They're actually jumping almost more than that. So he said that there are people who have thousands of jumps and they've, you know, nothing's ever happened. But once the chute fails to open, then there is, you're jumping from the sky, obviously. So obviously, it's quite dangerous in that sense. But yeah, obviously, now that we have parachutes and all that, it's not that dangerous. I mean, obviously, there's safety precautions. So it's not that much of a dangerous thing now. I hope that helps. Jazakallah khair. Yeah. Yeah.